Good morning, and hello.
So we will start with our today's session. So I'm welcoming you all to Live AI on Azure Meetup series. So today's webinar is on AI solution with cognitive services, and this is sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft, and this series is organized by ATC community. So moving forward to our community, Manisha, can you please change the slide? So you also have attended our previous virtual meetups or webinars. So we have started this our new Azure Tech community. In this community, anyone can join. Can you please
हेलो
हेलो, कैन यू हियर मी ऑल?
या नाउ एक्चुअली वी लॉस्ट सम टाइम्स अगो.
या, देयर इज अ नेटवर्क इशू. सो आई एम टेलिंग यू दैट दिस इज आर अजर टेक कम्युनिटी. मेनी ऑफ यू हैव ऑलरेडी अटेंडेड आर पास्ट मीटअप्स एंड वेबिनार्स. सो बेसिकली we have organized these webinars and meetup under this community, and those who are interested in Azure technologies, they can join our community. So if you want to join this community and directly get updated about our upcoming meetups and webinars, just visit Meetup, and in the Meetup you can search for the Azure Tech community, and from there you can join or follow our community. So you all can get directly you all get updates regarding our upcoming meetups and webinars and workshop. So moving towards our today's session, so our today's session is on AI solution with cognitive services. So basically then, Manisha, can you change the slide? Oh, sorry. Before moving towards the session, I would like to tell you some code of conduct about this series and our community. So whenever this code of conduct is kind of a terms and conditions, but during this webinar you can't record this session. If you want the recording, there is a you need to follow a process, and you just let me know, then we will tell you that process. Also, you can't get the screen shot of the presentation. So these are some rules and regulations you need to follow that. Now moving forward to our today's session, which is on AI solutions with cognitive services. So basically, when we think of any system or any application, that application or system, it will help us in decision making. It will be very helpful for us. So these cognitive services bring AI within a reach of every developer. And in this session, we will explain how you can deploy AI for various use cases using the programming languages that you already know. So and now I'm going to give you an introduction about our speaker for today's session, Mr. Navjyoti Bora. So he is a real gem in this mine of technology. He is an MVP technology and learning services at Synergetics. He has an experience of more than 30 plus years in this IT segment, and he has been offering best guidance to many Fortune companies regarding the enterprise integration solution. And he is a MCT, Microsoft Certified Trainer. He is a Microsoft Certified Solution Developer. Then he has also completed his certification in Microsoft, a certified technology specialist. And he has handling app modernization architect solution based on Microsoft Azure cloud platform for multiple MNCs, not only in India, but in USA, Singapore, and Sri Lanka. He has hands-on development experience in languages like .NET, Angular, React, Python, Node.js. Also, he is expertise in technologies like Azure PaaS, LaaS, Web Tools, OSS, mobile development platform. He has working on many projects of AI for many years. Now you all can know why I have called him a gem of technology, and I am sure he will definitely solve all your AI doubts. So there is one announcement before we start our today's session. So we are going to provide the certificate of participation, and many of you have attended our last webinar. So there is a problem in that survey form. So we are going to recirculate that survey form after this webinar, and we will give you the certification for both last webinar as well as for today's AI virtual meetup you have attended. And many of you haven't registered for today's meetup, so maybe you have get the link from direct WhatsApp or from our social media channels or from meetup group. So those who haven't registered and want this participation certificate, I will share my mail ID in the end of this session. In the message box, you need to message me your details, like your name, email ID, contact number, and you have attended today's session. After that, we will send you a survey form. Once you fill that form, you will get the participation certificate. So now we will move toward our today's session. Navjyoti sir, you can start our today's session.
Thank you, Priyanka, and good morning to all of you. I welcome you to this today's session of Building AI Solutions Using Microsoft Azure Cognitive Service. So let me pull my PPT, and that probably you can see my PPT just 1 or 2 minutes from now. So let me set the context for this today's session on, as I said, building AI solution with Microsoft Cognitive Service. Microsoft Cognitive Service is a set of services or set of API from Microsoft Cloud Platform. These are managed services. We don't have to do anything in order to write or update or modifications sort of things. These are ready-made services that is being aligned to a specific task to be performed in our day-to-day application that we develop using multiple tools and languages. And we through this session, we are going to explore those set of services that comes under the cognitive services. And we all of us aware that cognitive service is responsible for infusing the AI capability into the existing application or a new application. So we'll explore all those the services, and we'll see that how that services is going to deliver a different kind of the problem that we encounter or we get every now and then in order to create AI application. So this particular session is like there are a lot of people join, so it would be really difficult to kind of interact you all of you one by one or maybe over the mic that you have. But yes, during the session, I will pause some time or maybe end of the session. So I'll give some time for Q&A. And you can park your questions and you can ask me those questions through chat through the team. So it would be really difficult to speak over the mic. So I'm just setting the protocol how you can communicate to me in order to answer your queries. So there would be an explicit Q&A session at the end of this delivery or end of the session, or in between, so you can post your questions through the chat. Okay, so let me introduce myself. The Priyanka has already introduced me, but my name is Navjyoti Barua. I'm working as an AVP technology at Synergetics. I have been associating with Microsoft for last maybe a decade, and working with partners, helping partners to understand or implement Microsoft technology. But recently, I have been extensively working with the cloud platforms and the relative services. So in the field of AI, in the field of application modernizations, in the field of a database, and so on and so forth. So collectively, you know, it's I'm trying to help the customers to build an ecosystem with their existing applications, so while they will migrate them on the cloud and make them up and running. So primary focus would be the cloud platforms, as I said before, also the context of this particular session. But yes, so this session is going to pick up a couple of services around the AI solution. There may be multiple services would be associated along with the AI solutions, building AI solution. So we are going to go and explore all of them. But the primary focus of this particular session would be exploring those cognitive services, who can be a backbone for writing any intelligence applications using respective tools and technology. So you may be a developer coming from you know, Java or a .NET or a OSS background, but the primarily it does not make any sense when you talk about AI or cognitive services. You can infuse, you can call those APIs from all the technology that you have been using to develop your application. But the bottom line is that at the end of the day, you want to make your application intelligent. So essentially what we are trying to say that applications can take their own decision rather than using human brain to take decision you know, on behalf of a problem statement. And this is what we are going to go and see in today's session. So hope I can set the context right and what we are going to do during this session. And in between the session, I'm going to give you 10 to 15 minutes break because it is almost half an hour session. So I'll be giving a bio break in between. So I'll let you know when I'm going to give you the break. So let's get started then. And again, I would welcome all of you. The hope that this community technology, the session will definitely bring the opportunity for all of us, you know, to learn new technology, going back and implementing this technology in the respective fields. And these are the kind of emerging technology which is growing every now and then. And you will definitely look into the importance of how this technology is being you know, used in different use cases and problem statements and case studies going forward. So let me begin by giving a bit of overview of Microsoft Cognitive Service. So we need to just, before we go and practically do or explore those services, let us understand what exactly Microsoft Cognitive Service is. Now, when you think of developing AI-based application, as a developer, you can go and develop application, maybe a web application or a desktop application, or maybe a mobile application based on your skill, based on your technical expertise. So you come always develop those applications, and you have been developing applications, as I said, with using different tools and technologies. But the, when you talk about, you know, putting an artificial intelligence to an existing application or a new application, it's not an easy task. If you say, oh, the application has to take a decision, or application has to come back and tell me about something, what went wrong, or application has to tell me how to go about for something, you know, guiding me. These are all kind of, you know, implementations that we generally talk about the AI application. So coming back to the point, the developing an AI application is not so easy as a developer or .NET developer or a Python developer or maybe a Java developer. It's not easy. So why it is not easy? You know, a lot of computing, a lot of algorithms that you have to write on your own in order to develop things and align with AI requirement. And that is not possible to do overnight, or that is not possible to do within a couple of hours, or maybe, you know, within a couple of days. So, and the getting that kind of expertise or getting that kind of a skill also difficult any given point in time. And that is where people started looking for some kind of a pre-created services. And we all of us know that there are a whole lot of services around us. We have been talking about APIs, you know, application programming interface. So we don't talk API today. We have been talking about an API for since long. Now people started consuming, or people started consuming API from their respective application. Now, what is happening around us, those API that we have been using in general application, now there are API available for AI application also. So meaning somebody has already developed those API and they have put those API under a particular category, saying that, okay, I would like to do something from my applications. Let me figure out whether this particular API is available in order to use this API from my applications to solve the problem and that I'm facing at this moment, or to start developing that you know, solutions on my own. Let me go and call a APIs who can quickly solve the problem that I have been looking for. So it is really established in front of us that building an AI solutions from the scratch, from the bottom to top, is not just the easy task. Maybe, you know, maybe after some time you should be able to do that, but when you look into a problem statement so quickly, if you get onto the production environment, so it is not possible. And to address this problem, the cognitive service has popped in, you know, saying that, okay, Microsoft has taken the responsibility of offering a set of cognitive services. And that cognitive service will come to me as an API or SDK or a typical services that we consume from our existing application every now and then. So we just need to make a call to the API. We are going to get the result. So while I'm making a call to an API, I would ask what I want, what my API is supposed to deliver for me. That would be a crystal clear along with the API when you make a call to an API from my existing applications or from my new application that I'm about to develop. But at this moment, the cognitive service from the Microsoft is being aligned with the few problem domain. So as you can see, the core features included like speech or language, vision, search, or a decision. So going forward with the cognitive service, the many more, the problem area would be included. But at this moment, we are going to go and discuss a couple of them. But the idea is that, you know, to make you understand how easy it would be calling a cognitive service to do something quickly. Rather you sit back and write that service on your own and have no clue how to start with. As I said, a lot of computing, a lot of algorithms will go behind that compute service, which is typically aligned with the AI solution. It is AI is a extensive computing, the domain. It is not like a traditional computing that we have been doing for so many years. A lot of computing has to happen in the background in order to, give you the result, in order to predict something, in order to guide something, in order to identify something, and so on and so forth. So all those areas that you talked, we are going to discuss. So what under visions, what under decisions, what under languages, and what under speech, and all those things that we are going to get an overview. But during that process, I'll keep talking about those services. I'll give you a fair idea if tomorrow, if I have to go and use the services, where to begin and how to begin that particular, where to find those services. And I will give you a bit demo also, sort of to make you understand that. So we won't be able to do the demo for all, but yes, as I said, to get a fair idea where we find the cognitive service, the AI services from the Microsoft Azure, and how we can provision those services and how we can use those services from different environment. Either it would be a simple call as an API, or maybe using a SDK, or maybe using a typical services, that we usually consume from our applications any given point in time. So what idea that we got at this moment? So we are going to work with the pre-built services. Yeah, the pre-built services. So cognitive service is a pre-built services. That is the understanding. But those pre-built services is being aligned, or pre-built API is being aligned with certain domain at this moment. I discussed in the previous PPT also, here also coming in, vision, speech, language, search, and decision. And what we are going to get under the vision, what we are going to get under those respective domain. So we'll elaborate on this. I will walk you through all the cognitive service so far available from Microsoft Cloud Platform. So to see all the service together, as you can see, Microsoft Cognitive Service give your app a human side. The human is being used to take a decisions based on some data, based on some information. Today, application can do that job, but you have to infuse that AI capabilities into that applications any given point in time. And infusing of AI capability to an applications can be done by quickly calling an API who can deliver what you are looking for. So under the vision, as I said, as a category, what are the things typically addressed at this moment? They say the from faces, like recognizing a human face to feelings, like how that the face is looking any given point in time. So what is the feeling, whether it is happy or sad or something like that. Allow your app to understand the image and the videos. So if you upload an image and you ask this API that tell me what is there inside an image, I want to identify an object in the image. I want to identify the faces in an image or something like that. So this is typically done by the vision APIs, the vision cognitive service that we are going to see. Now, subsequently, we'll move into other type of service as you can speech. So hear and speak to your users by filtering noise, identifying speakers, and understanding the intent. So it's basically, something that we say, okay, I'm speaking, and what is my intent? What I'm trying to communicate? That is basically come up from the intent. What is my intent under which I am speaking? Right? So when somebody is speaking, you know, the cognitive service can identify the speaker, number one, and then what kind of talking, you know, so the intent of the speaking also can be elaborate or maybe narrated through the API that is available under this category. And then going with something like languages. So here, typically the language is what? Whatever I'm writing, you know, so maybe we can say process the text and learn how to recognize what user wants, something like this. The language, it's also like it is mostly used in technology called bot. Probably you need that. Most of the conversation today is happening through a bot. So implicitly bot is going to call a cognitive service. And a cognitive service is being used as a backbone or maybe a backend for the front-end bot application. So if user has to communicate with the end customers, you know, so how they're supposed to communicate, what test is being written by customer and how the other user in the other end is responding to that text. And that will come under the languages. So there may be a lot of language implicitly not understand by the standard English. Maybe the day-to-day basis, the kind of English that you use to interact with the customer or interact with the underlying system may be different. But your system will understand whichever way you try to communicate, whichever way you try to ask something, the system will understand because the system is being trained to understand your language any given point in time, because that's how you can increase the productivity of your business. Because if you cannot understand your customer, you won't be able to help your customer. You won't be able to address the customer problem. But since this is being driven by technology, there is no human sitting in the other end. So your system also equally equipped, your system also equally enhanced to understand every single things coming from the underlying customers in order to improve the customer service, in order to improve your service as a whole. And going with the knowledge, like tap into a rich knowledge, you know, from the web or academia for your own data, basically saying that, okay, you may go and kind of ask for any kind of the questions or any kind of queries for intelligence applications. If your application is building around to find out the knowledge, to find out, to give you a knowledge in different areas or different domain. So that is also possible through your application. And the typical, the search is the one thing, because applications become more intelligent today. Like, you know, you can ask your applications to go and find something for me. And because you are not writing to find something from the internet backbone, but you have integrated some services from your application, which is dedicated for finding something that you have asked for. Suppose you are trying to search an image or a particular web page or a particular videos from your customized app, you should be able to get it very quickly. And in fact, in that process, the application also come up and give you a suggestions what kind of image that you are looking for or what kind of videos that you are looking for. So it is giving a assistance to the end user, not only getting job done, but it will give you an assistance to the end user any given point in time to make a seamless communications between your applications and the underlying user. So it is all about, you know, we are getting into a complete different experience world today, because, you know, customer is too concerned or customer is too delicate today. You know, so how do you handle our customers? And of course, the business innovations have also gone far. It is not like how do you do business today in a traditional computing. The business become more intelligent, you know. the business, the way the business is being, you know, evolving around us, and the most of the business need help from the AI implementations, because, you know, everything cannot be done, everything cannot be delivered by the writing code with a set of developers. So we need to go back and take help from the ready-made services, which is basically bring into the innovations of creating intelligence applications every now and then. All right, so at the end, it is all about, you know, kind of lab. It is eventually, you know, if something the Microsoft is talking any given point in time, how Microsoft is going to ensure that this service is a publicly accepted, the service is globally accepted. You know, there are multiple labs or multiple, you know, project available to understand the customer views, to understand the customer opinions, and then they make that those services as a general availabilities. But until that, all the services would be under preview, under the observations. So the communities or maybe the developer from the across the world will give a kind of suggestions or a comment or a input. Based on that, Microsoft will go back and take a decisions whether this particular service to be updated or modified before they made that service generally available so that you can go back and use them in the production. All right, so this is how putting into more kind of elaborate of Microsoft Cognitive Service. You can see it right in front of you. Under the visions, we are going to see a very specific APIs like computer visions or content moderators or emotion face API, video indexer. So as you go on, you will keep learning. So here I'm not going to go and explain exactly what it does, but yes, going forward, you will know when to use what API that you are looking at. Under the speech, under the language, under the knowledge, under the search, under the lab, you can see. But sometimes what happened, you know, as I said before also, these are ready-made services. Understand the one point that I'm repeatedly saying, we don't go back and write our code. Whether you are a .NET or a Java developer, it doesn't make any sense. You know, so you are not writing the code on your own, number one. So you are going to consume or you are going to call those API any given point in time from your application. But sometimes your need may be beyond what Microsoft is giving or what Microsoft is trying to solve any given point in time. Then what? So can I go back and do some kind of customizations based on the existing services is available? The answer is yes. You can train your own data. So because while I'm using a word called train, the train is something so important in context of AI to understand. So when I have to go and ask somebody to do something in context of AI, that particular person or that particular piece of software to be trained to understand what I'm saying. That is so important. And typically that is being done by a technology called machine learning from Microsoft Azure. And as a machine learning, as a technology, it is nothing to do with only Microsoft Azure. It's a universal global technology in order to do some kind of predictive analytics or maybe other analytics related solutions through the machine learning. But here we are talking about, yes, the machine learning would be used behind the scene, behind the cognitive service in order to train a kind of data on what basis the API can give me the result or API can come back and tell what I was looking for. So as I said, these APIs are ready-made to deliver certain thing any given point in time. So if I want more, if I want my own things to be trained, my own kind of, you know, the data to be trained and so on and so forth, I can still go and do some kind of customization. So that could be a kind of custom vision service or a custom speech service or custom decision service, or maybe sometimes language understanding, or maybe something like customization on the Bing service going forward. So we are not saying that there is no customizations can be done on an existing APIs, that but API that we are talking about at this moment, these are the ready-made API, which is designed to deliver certain things in your AI application. All right, so the question is that, as I said, what is Azure Cognitive Service? We talk about only two things. These are ready-made API to deliver certain functionalities under certain categories. And these are the things that we discussed in the previous section of our presentation. Now, the question is that, you know, this is fine that you are talking about what is cognitive service. I understand that. But why cognitive service? Why Microsoft Cognitive Service? Microsoft Cognitive Service in the context is saying that there are three things. One is very easy. The second is flexible, and the third is tested. Now, how come it is very easy in context of Microsoft Cognitive Service? They say is roll your own with the REST API call, simple to add, just a few line of code required. So essentially what you're saying, so you don't build the entire applications. If you think of writing an applications to deliver some kind of artificial intelligence capabilities, you can do it quickly by calling a REST API, REST call. Or maybe the service that you have created, get a key of the service and infuse that key by using some kind of SDK while you'll be building an applications using different technology. That is also possible. And then second point, it's talk about the flexibilities. Now, under the flexibility, it says integrate into your language and platform of your choice. The breadth of offering help you find the right API for your app, bring your own data for your custom experiences. And that is to always there. And we can use any platforms that you can see. It could be sort of Windows, Android, or iOS, working with different, we're not picking up all the languages like Nodes, Pythons, .NET, Javas, and any kind of applications today you develop, you can infuse, you can make a call to the cognitive service APIs any given point in time. And since Microsoft is being known for enterprise services, because they are in the technology field for the decades, you know, it is not one or two, it's like it's many, many years. They have actually proven all over again that kind of service they have created, kind of service that is being given to the, you know, Fortune 500 companies, to an SMB. So everybody knows that, the kind of the qualities of their service, because it is being tested, it is being delivered, it is being used in multiple use cases and so on and so forth. And you can get all the code in the GitHub, you know, so what kind of coding is being done, because it is basically a community driven a project. The code is available in the GitHub if you really want to try with those cognitive service. So it's made it available everywhere and tested and working with, you know, the corporate client and engaging with them to deliver their critical problems they face every now and then. And that's how the answer of the why Microsoft Cognitive Service has come into the picture. Now today, it is a never-ending story, because, you know, if we talk back, you know, coming back to the real applications, real implementations, there are multiple applications where the cognitive service would be used. All right, where the cognitive service would be used. So we cannot go after a particular application, but here we can see like under a visions, under a speech or a language or a knowledge or a search. So you can see all of them. So we just need to align our applications respectively to work with all kind of cognitive service that could be aligned to the varieties of applications in today's. As I said, today's applications becoming more robust in and it will become more complex and robust days to come, because everybody is talking about the AI implementations. Everybody is delegating the human task to an application in the first level. And you may be experiencing with talking to the bot any given a point in time. So when you want to buy something, the first thing, your first conversations that has happened with the bot, you know, so bot is going to answer you. So this is how the bot will understand what you have asked for. So there is a cognitive service to understand your language, which is being infused in the bot, and the bot is taking help of that cognitive service in order to answer the questions that you are, asking through a bot canvas. So that is something that, you know, you will keep using every now and then. So that is what I'm saying. That could be any application going forward, and you'll keep learning one after another in different contexts. But as I said, as I promised in the beginning, I'll show you how to do it, how to actually get your hand dirty in those spaces. You know, what is how we can get my cognitive service working from Microsoft Cloud Platform. So as I said before, also now we got a kind of the ecosystem of the cognitive service on the Microsoft Cloud, and we'll go and discuss one by one. As I promised in the beginning, the couple of service I'm going to showcase you, couple of service I'm going to walk you through, and then you will get a fair idea, because this is the same thing that you will subsequently do for the rest of the service, what we are going to go and talk about through our presentation. So here under the vision category, as you can see, there are a few things that is being delivered by the vision API so far. So either it could be a computer vision API that is distilled actionable information from an image. This is basically saying that, okay, you are trying to figure out there is a noise, so let me mute that. All right, so coming back to the vision category, so when I am saying under the computer vision, so it said distill the actionable information from an image. Like, you know, if I'm giving an image to a computer vision API, I'm looking for something. Maybe I want to know the kind of under which tag that image comes in, or I want to know the description of that particular image. So because it is no human to describe that particular image, the application has to describe, application has to go back and tell what is there in that image. So, and then based on that information coming back to an application, so I can take a call or I can do something on those informations, on the data that is returned by the cognitive service, the vision API. So subsequently, the concept remained the same for other API also, like face API, detect a particular face, identify, analyze, organize, and tag faces in photos. Like emotion API, personalized experience with the emotion recognitions, whether, as I said, whether this person is happy or sad or, you know, neutral and so on and so forth. Content moderators, you know, it's basically moderate the content, the text and the image from a particular a conversation, or from a particular documents, or a particular resources, and so on and so forth. And the custom vision service is typically responsible for doing some kind of customizations. I say, rather working with the inbuilt services, I can also create my service by customizing, by customizing, or maybe, you know, by training my own data, what I want and how I want. That could be controlled from yourself any given point in time. Video indexer also come under the vision, like process and extract smart insight from a videos. Like the video is being played, now you can read the videos. Who all are the person in that videos? What they are talking about? So getting inside of an object is, or getting inside of a particular entity become so important today's, scenario or today's applications that we talk about. So getting inside. So go and get the inside, and I want to know more on it. I want to know more about something. I want to take a decision by knowing more on that something. And this is the questions, and these are the requirement, you know, keep coming from all the complex application, all the robust applications that we talked about every now and then. Right, so going with this, the other category, as I said, discussed also before, and talking about Bing search APIs or speaker recognitions API or custom speech services and so on and so forth. These are all the service at the end of the day. So we just need to know how that services or is going to be relevant services in my workload or in my application that I'm developing. And that is the only point that you have to go back and anticipate and start working with those services. And as I said, because Microsoft service, Microsoft APIs that we are talking about, cognitive service API, is so easy to use from your existing application or maybe new applications that you will realize sometime from now. So under the language also, you know, these are all kind of definitions that we have been talking about, you know, in a more in detail. But until you go and really work, until you go and really see things, you know, so you won't be able to anticipate how easy it would be while I'm talking about a cognitive service, whether it could be a language or a vision, it doesn't matter, because the process of using all the APIs that I'm talking about would be the same. So if I can use one API, the other API would be also same. So if you, in context of SDK, you have to learn those SDK from the heterogeneous language from where you want to consume those. That is the only thing that you probably need to explore. But as far as the API is concerned, it keep coming back and keep going with the same way that you consume from everywhere. Right, so in fact, I just pick up a kind of, under the knowledge, this is something important to understand. Other things that you can see, that the Q&A maker. Now, the Q&A maker is a service. The Q&A is one of the most important component of any kind of business solutions that we talked about today. You are buying a product, then you go through a bit of Q&As about the product, you know, because you want to know about the product, then only you buy. Or maybe after buying that product, you know, you want to operate that product, but to begin with that products, you do not know how to operate that product, how to, you know, start using that product. They gain another set of Q&A. So your Q&A will keep coming back to you every now and then. So rather we give as a solution provider, rather we put somebody to answer your Q&A any given point in time related to that particular domain or related to that particular product, that is inevitable. That is going to come anyway from now. So we understand our business today. We understand what is going to go and make our business more productive and more robust. And this is how the Q&A will come into the picture. So any point in time, if somebody asks for some things, the system has to ready. A system has to be ready to answer those questions. The common questions would be asked by any individual. So you can configure a set of Q&As along with your application. And you can eliminate the human from your application to answer those questions on a given areas, on a given domains, and any given point in time. And it's a very interesting one. In fact, you know, the Q&A, if I get time, so I'll show you that how that Q&A can be used, how that Q&A can be one component under the knowledge, under the cognitive service that you are going to see. So similarly, going into the another one, so you can say what possibly done, because this is also one capability, searching and informations and finding informations or maybe content or maybe documents or maybe something else is extremely important today. So how this cognitive service is going to help us to do that by integrating with our application. So giving not only just going and typing something, so application will help me by giving suggestion. So what I'm looking for, what is my interest areas, and all those things can be popped in through my application. So it is all about the UI of an application, how you want to moderate, how you want to go ahead with your application at the end of the day. So talking about the visions coming in, so let me go back and say how this vision is going to return, or how this vision is going to, a vision API is going to react to my call, to my queries. So they say the vision API can come back and tell you a couple of things. They said, okay, analyze an image. So the vision API is responsible for analyzing an image. So what goes inside that analyzing an image? It says, understand the content within an image. Or optical character recognition, that is OCR, detect and recognize the word within an image. If somebody is writing some kind of characters on top of the image, the cognitive service can read it for you. That is OCR. Or you can ask your cognitive service to generate the thumbnail for any image that you have uploaded to the cognitive service API. Scale and crop image while retaining the key content without compromising the content, so you can crop your image. You can convert into a thumbnails in respective way. Or you can recognize the celebrities, you can recognize the kind of, you know, the places and so on and so forth. So domain specific models, ability to recognize, you know, 200K celebrities from a business, politics, sports, entertainment around the world. So suppose somebody do not know who this person is, you can ask cognitive service. The cognitive service will come back and tell you who is this person. If cognitive service is being trained to understand that person, it is all about training. So cognitive service is being internally trained to understand your data any given point in time. And that is being done by the machine learning, as I said in the beginning. So there would be an algorithms written behind the machine learning to train those data, and basis of those trained data, you should be able to predict, you should be able to come back and tell me what is this image is all about, because the content of the image is being trained already to an API. So API has actually memorized the content of that particular image. So anytime from now you go back and ask the API, what is that content is all about, the API should be able to tell you, because they are trained on that content that you are about to ask or you are going to ask in the near future. So like this, you know, it could be you can go and talk about, okay, let me go and analyze this image. So you are going to go and get something, like, for example, saying that, okay, the content of an image is talking about people underscore swimming, the score getting, what is the score? Because see, the bigger the score means it is more closer to that predictions that you are making. Adult content is not there. Adult score also this one. And then the face, maybe you are calling a face APIs in order to get a few metadata from that face APIs, going back and telling me what gender of that particular, what is the gender of this particular person, what is the age of this particular person from the face rectangle that you can see. This is the rectangle. So the data, whatever the data coming out of this rectangle has gone into the API, that is your cognitive service. The API was trained to understand this data. Because maybe the API was trained, you know, all the object coming out of the same, like, you know, eyes or maybe nose or maybe mouth or maybe a forehead or something like that. We have no clue. There may be an algorithms that is being implement internally to work with this API to come back and tell you what kind of metadata that you supposed to identify, you supposed to, you know, kind of get as a result. So these may be one, all those things that we are getting in. So any applications after getting the detail that we are talking about using the image analyzer, you can make use of this data. You can go and make use of this data for, you know, different contexts, different use cases that you can bring into the forum, that bring into your application. So here we are talking about only the cognitive service and their capability, but going forward, you need to understand, you need to bring, or you need to align those concepts in the respective domain and respective use cases, respective, you know, kind of requirement from your workload. And that will come some point in time from now onwards. So by definitions, what is computer vision then? So Azure's computer vision service provide the developers with an access to advanced algorithm that process image and return information depending on the visual features you are interested in, that you would be asking what you want. So for example, computer visions can determine if an image contained adult content, or it can find all of the human faces in that particular image. This is what exactly we did in the previous example. So it is all about describing an image under the computer vision at this moment, including the human face going forward, that you are going to get explicit API like face or an emotion APIs and so on and so forth. You know, but at this moment, collectively, we are looking for the computer vision. So now time has come to show you a demo because this is so important. So I'm not going to give a demo for all cognitive service that we are going to discuss, but I'll give you certainly a demo, one or two, that you will get a fair idea from where do I go, and as I said before also, from where I can go and find those cognitive service, how am I supposed to use the cognitive service, and so on and so forth. And then you can align yourself what is needed at this moment to work with the cognitive service. But we all of us need to realize one thing in the beginning of the session that we are talking about, whatever we are doing, we are going to do on Microsoft Azure cloud platform. So in order to do the demo of the cognitive service at this moment, you can do it from the outside without the subscription also, but you know, so we need a subscription. You can get a free call to the cognitive service outside from your subscription also. That is always possible to test it, but when you go into a production, when you really want to work with those cognitive service that we'll be discussing throughout the sessions, so you need Azure subscription. You need an Azure subscription any given point in time. So this is something that what I'm going to go and give you a kind of a demo with my own subscription. So first thing, I have to have my Azure subscription that is already done with me. And then we'll figure out, we'll log into my subscription and start looking at all the cognitive service that I supposed to work. And the cognitive service is not alone most of that time. The cognitive service may go use and different services from Microsoft Azure because it's a build a complete ecosystem. It is not just only one thing that we are going to. So I'm going to talk about that also, how you can think about building an ecosystem around the Microsoft Azure services when you call a cognitive service any given point in time. So we'll get a fair idea that also. It is not about just making an API call, but you know, what would be the subsequent services that you may use any given scenario that you are going to implement in the near future. So let's go and jump into my subscriptions and start implementing or start figuring out where do I find my cognitive service? How do I go and use those cognitive service for in context of the vision API, the computer visions that I am going to work so under the demo. So I'll take you to another system at this moment where I will do the demo. All right, so the first thing, I'll open my browser. I'll go to the portal.azure.com with my subscription credential. So I logged into that, my subscriptions with my own credential. By the way, if you want to try the cognitive service, you can always go and create the free trial also subscription. So you can say Azure free trial account. You will go and start your free trial account. You can always go and create a free trial account that will also take you into the same the management portal that I am right now in. So I'm going to go and create some kind of the dashboard. Maybe I'll go and say create a dashboard. So I'm just saying a cognitive service demo. Now, the first thing, suppose I'm going to go with a computer vision service. So what I'll do, I'll go and create. I can go into an AI and machine learning, as you can see. So you have multiple services that we talk about. So one of the services that we just now discussed is called computer vision, or maybe face, or maybe text analytics, or maybe Bing search, and all those things come under the AI and machine learning. So you can see all of them out there, AI and machine learning, you know, what all are the product out there. So this is the Azure marketplace. You can see more. So that is something that you can always go and see more on this if it is available out there. So you can see cognitive service, what you can see. So these are, we are using software as a service. So somebody has developed that, somebody has trained that service. For me, I just go and create. So one of the service that I'm talking about in under the AI, building AI application, is Q&A Maker. That is also interesting that what we are going to see sometime from now. But yes, these are the list of cognitive service under the cognitive service. This, so we can pick up one of them and we can start working and start understanding how we are supposed to deal with those services. Maybe I can make a direct call to the service, or maybe I can integrate with my applications using an SDK respective to the language. All right, so going back there again, so AI and machine learning out there at this moment, so I can see something like new out there. So I go with something called computer vision. Or I can directly go and find something called, if I go to a queue new, and I can say a cognitive service. So I can go and see a cognitive service, but when you create a cognitive service, it is an umbrella technology. Umbrella technology, umbrella service means under the cognitive service, I can make use of multiple things rather going and explicitly create only for computer vision. So if I go with only computer vision, means I can only do computer visions, not anything else. So I can create a root level service, or I can go with the specific service from the list. So I would like to go with the specific service that I have with me at this moment, because I'm talking about computer vision. So what was the computer vision? You are going to go and see how computer visions can be created. So let me go back again. Maybe I can go from here. So create a new resource, and I said computer a vision. So why I'm going from there? Because it will give you a bit of overview on that particular service that we are about to create. So we are about to create a service. Okay, so we are about to create a service called a computer vision. So what it does? So it said boost the content discoverability, accelerate the text extractions, and create product that more people can use by embedding visions capabilities in your app. Okay, use visual data processing to label the content from the object to the concept, or maybe extract the printed handwritten text, that is OCR that we discuss. Recognize the familiarity subject like brand or landmark. So they can figure out the landmark also. And moderate the content, you know, so moderating the content also being done through this computer vision. So there is a very interesting point that you can see. To do that, you don't need a machine learning expertise. So it means you do not know the domain of the machine learning, because machine learning is a big domain. It's a big technology altogether. So when you talk about machine learning, then you need to talk about algorithms. You need to talk about training them. You need to talk about the modeling of data and so on and so forth. The critical part would be an algorithms, the working with different type of algorithms that we talk about under the concept of regressions or classifications and so on and so forth in context of statistical data. So we go with a computer visions to create that. So I can say, okay, sample computer, or maybe we can say CV SRV API. So I'm just a sample computer vision service API. So that is an API that we do, or we can make it something like this also. So I just need to see. The name of my service to make it more meaningful what we are doing. And my subscription name is Visual Studio Ultimate with an MSDN. So if you create your free, then you will get the free subscription out there. And where I want to deploy this cognitive service, like, you know, the cognitive service is available in certain geographic a region where Microsoft has set up their data center to make those services available to the end customer. Because we know Microsoft Cloud Platform is a multi-tenant public cloud. It is not about me, it is about every one of us. You also can go to the same data center. I can also go into the same data center in order to use the same service, but all of us would be put in a multi-tenant environment. So I'm one tenant and you would be another tenant. Although both of us will be working on the public cloud. So I'm trying to consume a service from a public cloud, and I have identified my regions, the data center where this particular service to be deployed. That's number one. And second thing, we go with something called a pricing tier. How am I going to pay that? So there is something called, you have already created. So I have already a cognitive service up and running. So I have already used my F0. So this time I'll go with the S1. So you can go and see the full view of the pricing detail. So if I go and open my pricing detail to understand how I supposed to pay for my cognitive service, you will get to know. Suppose I said, okay, I'm going to deploy my cognitive service somewhere in the East US. And how am I going to go and, you know, get the pricing concept in the computer vision? So pricing detail that you can see how you are going to go and pay. So free means web containers, 20 call per a minute. So that is the transaction per second. That is TPS. That is something what we see. Okay, and then you won't be able to get or incorporate the different features and all because it is free, but you go into S1, most of the things that you are going to get it. So it is a quick view. We don't have to go and stick around that because it is just an understanding rather going into a pricing things, but everything that we use from the Microsoft Azure, you have to pay for that. You don't get them free. You get free, but that is not being used in a production environment because you don't get features under the free tier. If you go with any service, there are a whole lot of service that you can consume for free for your POC, proof of concept, or maybe some kind of testing job that you do on the Microsoft cloud environment. So I want to put this service under a group. So because that is mandatory under the Microsoft Cloud platform, so I go and say a sample resource group. So under sample resource group, I am going to create a computer vision service. Hope everyone understands. It's a pretty simple and clean. So I'm going after the computer vision service, the API that we are talking about. I'm giving a name. I have identified my subscriptions under which this particular service is going to be deployed, the locations, the data center, the region that I have selected from here, and how I want my cognitive service to be used by selecting a multiple pricing tier, but looking at the features and functionalities that I'm going to use and putting them in a resource group. So we go with just create that. So deployment is started in progress. Once it is done, so I'll go to the next service, which should be used from the cognitive service. So I pin that one. It is pretty quick. I can go to a dashboard. I can see my computer vision. Under the cognitive service banner is available right in front of me. It's an active service. And if you go into the service, you can see the detail of the service. You can go to the overview of the service. So you get to see all of them. So now this service would be called by using an endpoint. You can see the endpoint. So name of the service and the default domain of the cognitive service that has come from the Microsoft Cloud platform. Here it says cognitiveservice.azure.com. So it means, so under this endpoint, the cognitive service is available. And in order to call this cognitive service using an endpoint, you can see those keys. So it means the consumer has to give the key. Then only this particular service would be made available to the consumer. Because until we get a key to call that service, we are not an authorized individual to call this service any given point in time. Because every time we make a call to the service would be recorded in the telemetries of the service, because based on that, the bill will come to me. How many calls that you made? Because that is the quota that was assigned in the beginning to pay some amount for those services at the end of the month. Like your electricity or telephone bill that you go and pay what you consume. So you have no clue how this cognitive service is going to deliver the task that you asked for, because the cognitive service is already being trained, already being developed, already being used internally, a lot of technology in order to give you what you have asked for. So it's pretty simple. So one service that I'm going to create under this particular demo, so that I'm going to create a storage account where I'm going to store the image that I want to evaluate through my cognitive service. So I go and say storage account. So I pick up the same resource group that just now I have created, something called sample group. I want to include this service also under the same group. The storage account, I can go and say sample storage. And here also I go to the same locations where I deploy my cognitive service, STUS, Okay, and so I'm not going to go and talk about more on the storage. It was just to store my image. I'm creating a service on the cloud. So I'm just going with the default selection. And I go and create the store. Now, if cognitive service is being supplied with an image, so I need a repository of an image. So most of the time, the repository of the image would be on the storage, would be on the cloud services, or maybe in a physical file sitting on your laptop or a desktop. That is also possible. If you are really writing an applications and, you know, you are really giving a physical path to pick up the images in order to, so in order to basically go and, you know, perform the task that we are talking about. So it's pretty quick. So we go and pin it. So I go inside my storage account. And there is a storage called container. It is blob. So I create some image, like suppose I can go and say my images. So I made this particular container public that people can publicly access this container to access the images sitting inside the container. I go and create that one. And I go inside the container and I go and upload a few images. So let me go back to my few images. And I upload those images. So uploading of the image is done to the storage. And now if I go back to one of the images, like for example, I just go and get into one of the images, it will give me the URL to that image. If I go and see this URL, how this URL look like, this is my storage account and this is my container name. And inside the container, I have an image and that image can be publicly accessed. So my API can access this image. What API? The API that I'm talking about, computer vision. So if I ask my API to go and get the image from this public place, they can go and get it for me and start analyzing an image and come back with the data that I'm interested to. So if I directly go and paste to test that, whether I can get access to this image from the browser or not. This is what I get. All right. So this is something that we need to see. Again, I go and get one more one. So let me just go back to this, the first image. And then we go back to your stuff. And here we are, the previous image that we discussed. All right. So we will be figuring out, because this is just, we are trying to browse the image directly from the storage, but that URL has to given to my cognitive service. Now, cognitive service that I'm talking about, the computer vision, is going to give me the metadata that I'm asking. What I'm going to do at this moment, so let me go to one of my browser details. So I go and get into an API. So you can see that API documentation. So this is an API, and these are the reference of an API that we can see at this moment. So API is basically, everybody knows that API can be make call from a kind of your maybe something like Postman, and then you can use, or maybe Fiddler that you can use from the browser itself. But yes, it is just a make a call. It is doesn't mean that what kind of applications that you are using, whether it could be a Postman that you are using, whether it could be a Fiddler that you are using, or whether it could be a Microsoft inbuilt a canvas from where you can make a call to the cognitive service. So you will get the API for all. So like, you know, so you can see that, okay, I'm trying to analyze an image or describe a particular image. For example, I want to know the description of an image. So you can see that this is the API definitions you can download. You can see the metadata of an API version 3.0 under the computer vision. So you are giving me a canvas to make a call to my computer vision service. So computer vision API provide a state of art algorithm to process images that we have been talking about. And this API is currently available those regions. So I'm using my, I have deployed my API somewhere on the East US, as you can see that. And so these are the detail of a kind of how this, the description of the image is going to come in right in front of me. So this input method are supported, something like uploading an image and specifying an image URL. So this is something that we have done, uploading an image, and I have got that a particular image URL that I can go and analyze my image from this canvas that is right coming, that is straight away coming from the Microsoft documentation. So I select my East US, already being selected. You can say eastusdev.cognitiveservice.com. And you are under an API metadata, definitions of the API. So you can also go and how you want to enter, what language that you want to interact with the cognitive service. So at this moment, I'm using an English language. That would be a query parameters going along with the query that is being made a tool. So that is something like what you said, that is eastusapi.cognitiveservice.com, or maybe the cognitive service that we have created, you can give the name of the resource. That would be done sometime from now later on, because we have already created a cognitive service, you know, the. So let me copy this URL also. So we have already created in the dashboard, we can see, I can go and give the name of the cognitive service from the overview. From the overview also, you can see that there is a name of the cognitive service right on the top. So you can copy that. You can come here, sorry, and you can set it up the second one. That is your resource name. But I would like to go with the default, because we just need to understand how we are supposed to make a call to the cognitive service by posting, by giving, by sharing the image URL. All right, so I'll go with so we are ready to make a call, but there are a couple of things that we need to understand. The number one, how am I supposed to go and a call, or maybe, you know, how am I supposed to go and avail the service which is available under the Microsoft Cloud platform? So I need to be authorized. So they are going to ask me, who am I, any given point in time. So I have to supply the credential. So we have already created. Okay, and then I go to the key and endpoint. And I can go and say, okay, let me see the key, the primary key. I copy that primary key. I come back and I paste that. This is the key that I'm giving it. So the subscription key that I have because I have been authorized myself that what I want. So then we said input process within the post body, a support input method, a raw image or a binary or an image URL. So what I'm going to give the image URL, just now I copied. So let me just go and copy this. And in the JSON document, as the property values, the URL property values, and I'm doing that, or I'm ready saying that, okay, this would be the input to the cognitive service I am about to call. So my request URL would be something like this. So my request URL saying that, okay, go to this cognitive service region with a particular version, and I want to describe, I want to get the description of that particular image. You know, max candidate is 1, 1 is only calling at this moment, and language is EN. But at the same time, so in the request body, I'm sending my the URL to that image that is sitting under my storage account. So I can go and send this. So if I get the response 200 status code, means everything is fine. So response latency has come to me 1.0 millisecond. And what is the body of the response that I get? It said the descriptions under the tag, it could be a water, sports, swimming, pool, man riding blue ocean, young, web, word, a game, lures, a standing, and so on and so forth. Because this particular image may come under the tags that is being identified the cognitive service and return that metadata, return that descriptions back to as a response. So I haven't done anything. Although we are just making a simple call to this particular service any given point in time. So you say this caption of this particular image should goes like a person swimming in the pool of water with the confidence of 87% that you can see at this moment. And other metadata that you are going to get in. So net, what we are trying to say that we can make a simple REST call on the cognitive service. As I said, we can make a REST call on the cognitive service, and the cognitive service is going to get me the result the way I want it. So essentially what we are trying to say at this moment, it means you do nothing at your end because you haven't done anything in order to get that result. You did only one thing. You just made a call to the cognitive service URL that you have created in the respective regions by providing the credentials in order to call that service. That's it. So whether you are calling it from this space, Canvas, or whether you are calling it from the AI applications to do this, it's up to you. And whether this application is being developed in .NET or maybe Java or maybe Python or Node.js, it's up to you. So this is something what we are talking about as a whole of a cognitive service at this moment. All right, so this is, and then of course, I mean, like we can go and talk about, you know, analyzing an image. So what kind of, so then if I click on an analyzing an image. So if you click on the analyzing an image, so if I go to and select an East US. And then we can talk about, you know, the query parameters, you said, what would be a category, what you want to analyze, the category that you want to go and give it. So you can say, okay, I want to go and analyze something like the tags or an object, or is there any adult contents out there? So I want to go and, you know, query on that, right? So maybe a detail of these things, maybe a celebrities or landmarks and whatever it may be, languaging. So you can have multiple, or you can go and remove those also. Right? The categories or a brand or a descriptions and so on and so forth, or maybe a face and kind of stuff. So then you have to go and give that particular image, and then you have to go and apply a human face, then it will give you the detail of that particular face. So it is all about the practice going back that you would be doing. I don't want to repeatedly do things, but my point is that how quickly you can test the different metadata that we are looking at before we take them to the productions, before we really go and write your applications and in order to make it happen. All right. So now this was the direct call that we made. This was a direct call that we said, what about from application, how we are going to incorporate the cognitive service from application point of view? Suppose I am developing some application and how this application is going to integrate my cognitive service in order to do something, in order to do some kind of things that we are looking for. So what I'm going to do at this moment, so let me go back to one of the development environments. Although the people may be joining in this particular, the event may not have a background of the technology that I'll be using, but it is just to showcase you how easy it would be. So I'll be picking up the .NET applications, and from how .NET application using the Cognitive Service SDK can be clubbed together and build an intelligence applications to different things out there. So I'll not make a kind of, you know, the robust applications or something like that. You'll get to know the integrations of the SDK to deal with the cognitive service. That is something that I'm going to showcase right now using my existing application. So let me go and pull out that applications through my development environment. So I'll go and open a Visual Studio as a IDE 2019. So in the meantime, so I'll go and open my existing application. So I'll open the solution. Restoring is completed, so let me pin that solution. Okay, just a quick, the demo in context of SDK that I'm talking about, you know. So, for example, I have a client, something like this CLI. And from the CLI, suppose this is the client applications who wants to perform an API call, who wants to basically go and call an API, the API that we have been talking about, and it is a .NET application. Now, what we need to do in order to engage with an API call, the first thing, we go to some kind of configurations, and just to ensure that these are the relevant services that we talked about. Like, for example, I go and create a cognitive service, this TUS API cognitive service that we have created. So you can also see that the visions out there, the vision APIs that we are talking about at this moment, maybe version 3 or version 1, it doesn't matter. So this is already we have done. So cognitive service keys that we talked about, it's already done at this move. So now, since we are talking about cognitive service keys, so what I can do, I can go back to my management portal, and I can go and create a root cognitive service. So I go with the cognitive service. I create a cognitive service. Again, I'm say simple cog SRV. So that is a cognitive service. I go to the East US pricing tier. Go with that. Sorry, this is. And I confirm below stuff. I simply go and create this. All right, so once this cognitive service got created, so this is done, so we can go and pin it to from here itself. We can go to a dashboard. So here we have a cognitive service at this moment, and we can step in there and to see few things at this moment. So this is exactly that we said this. This is my URL that you can see, eastusapicognitiveservice.com. So I can copy this. And this is exactly the same one that we are talking about. But anyway, so we can also go and bring it there. So eastus, this is the cognitive service that I'm talking about, because I'm configuring my application in order to call this cognitive service. apicognitive.microsoft.com, right? So apicognitive.microsoft.com, and the version that you are using explicitly from the SDK that is aligned with my .NET 1.0. And then, so I need the key from there. So I'll go and get the key right from there. So there is a click here to manage the key. So I'll see that key. First primary key, I can bring that key and I can go and replace that key out there. Now in this configuration setting.json, so in this configurations which need to be a kind of used by my application. So I'll go with some kind of stores here. If we see that stores out there. So I have already created my storage account, but I need to create a container name called images. So let me go and create a container name under the storage account that I have created. This is my storage account. Last time we have gone and upload a few images under the the my image that we have tested our cognitive service, I mean like computer visions right from my API dashboard. So I'll go and create another containers, and I'll give this container as this one. And I will not go and upload anything inside the image container. So let my application do that. So essentially my application is going to upload the list of images to this container under the storage account. At the same time, my application will go and call a cognitive service to analyze those images, and my client application will bring back that images into the client dashboard, into the client workspace. Or after analyzing those data, where you want to go and store those data, that is also we can go and talk about. So if you go back and you see that, so there is another database that I am creating, which is called Cosmos DB. Now it is extremely important in the ecosystem of the cognitive service, how the cognitive service will go and pump the data into the relevant service in the ecosystem of the cognitive service deployment on the cloud. It's extremely important. We talk about storage, we talk about cognitive service, and we talk about now the Cosmos DB. Now, Cosmos DB is a multi-model database management system on Microsoft Azure to store data in a form of JSON, the form of lightweighted content. Okay, so this is something that we need to go and do it. A minute. All right, so here, since we are on this Cosmos DB, so we need to go and create an account of the Cosmos DB. So let me go and create an account of Cosmos DB, store the metadata after analyzing those images. And I want that metadata to be put on a particular a database that from there we can bring it to a dashboard or something like that. So the third, the last component of the solutions that we are going to create, let's go and create a Cosmos DB account. Here we are, so we can go and say okay, Cosmos DB. So I'll pick up the same resource group that I have been working. It become easy for me to delete everything after the completing of this session. Otherwise, I have to go one by one. So I can delete the entire resource group to delete everything under that particular group. So account name, again, I'm giving the same name kind of thing, sample Cosmos DB, maybe S. And then we'll go with the default one. So here we are not going to talk about the detail of this. So here I'm selecting the same location where I have been deploying all of them. I just simply go and create that Cosmos DB account also. And I'll get the informations from the Cosmos DB, and I will fill it up this information is what you can see at this moment. So let me finish this creation of these things. It will take some time, 2 to 3 minutes, creating the Cosmos DB. is going. All right, so when you talk about that storage account, somebody asked in between, like, you could have created. No, so I think you did not understand the point. So let me explain that. So if you go to the storage account, so we have created two container under the storage account. Okay, one is the my image. So the my image container is already full of images. I need an empty container. So programmatically, I just want to bring the images inside the container by using a few the SDK integration. So this is a complete new thing. It is nothing to do with an existing nothing to do with what we have created. It's a complete different context, complete different things that we are doing. All right. So coming back, that it's still going on. Okay, so a few questions that I would like to answer at this moment, which is being asked. So here is the same thing, can we implement in Node.js? I have been repeatedly talking about that. It is all about the SDK that you can incorporate with the target applications that you would like to do. So it can be done from the Node.js, it can be done from the Python, it can be done from the .NET, it can be done from the Java. It is all about making a call to the API. So I hope that all the developer, whoever is attending this today's session, is basically have made call in the past to the API, but this time it is just an API relevant to the cognitive service, relevant to an API, but fundamentally we are not doing something different from the development perspective. The consistency of development model is out there for all of us at any given point in time. Okay, somebody asked about, it seems there are limitations of regions for cognitive service. So how can we propose these solutions to the client locations in different regions? So absolutely a valid question. I think this is one of the valid questions, you know, that I can see. See, Microsoft Azure, when you go by the, it is not about cognitive service. Don't look at it as a cognitive service. You see there are 255 services on Microsoft Cloud Platform. Now, all 255 services not available in all the regions, essentially means all the geographic region. So we have to convince, we have to go back and tell our customer for whom you are developing the solutions, and this is the service that you have to call. So there may be a question of latency, there may be a question of, you know, so, but you need to do some kind of work around, maybe going forward, multiple services is available to do and work around, you know, how you're supposed to kind of deal with that. But yes, that is inevitable, that is constant, you know. So the services can be used only from those geographic locations as of now, which is generally available. So we cannot get those service. It is not only to a cognitive service, it is for all services. You know, like in India, we have got 3 data center from the Microsoft Azure. We don't get all the services available in India region, India data center. So we have to go back to the respective locations to bring them back into my solution. But we never know, maybe those, because to begin with those services, initially it would be available in a couple of regions, but eventually it would be available in all. So it is all about time that we have to wait. So once it is done, you can migrate that service to the nearest one, nearest to the customer one, to, you know, to implement, to address the latency problem that we talked about. So somebody asked, can you get the sample application up? Yes, you will be given it. So I'll be sharing my mail ID so you can communicate with my mail ID. I can give you a OneDrive link from where you can download this applications that I'm putting. Okay. So US regions created service will work only for US based client. No, nothing like that. See, so this is a cloud service. It is no global region restrictions. We talk about only latency. So if I'm making a call a service, which is all the way going into a US data center to execute that service, maybe we need to compromise with the latency. But so there is no restriction, as long as you have the authority, as long as you have the key, as long as you have the, you know, the identity to call a service, you can go ahead and call a service from anywhere else. Right? So there is no restriction to a particular region. So to answer to the question, so there is no restrictions to a particular region, not only for cognitive service, for all, because the concept goes to all service. Cognitive service is one of them. I'm talking about approximately 300 services, which is available on Microsoft Cloud at this moment. It applies to all. It's globally available. So no restrictions is going to be imposed by Microsoft that you can call or somebody else cannot call, something like that. Yeah, somebody asked about, they said, okay, so you do not have a deep knowledge of the machine learning. Perfect. This is the good, again, equations coming in. Of course not. Until you want to do that kind of customization. So customization meaning, like for example, I said, okay, what is being told by my cognitive service? I don't want to stick to that. I have my own things to do. I have to kind of go and manipulate the output, because I want to train my own data, then probably we need to jump into the machine learning. Then you talk about algorithms and, you know, under a particular categories and so on and so forth. But at this moment, the machine learning is inbuilt along with the cognitive service. So you don't need to bother. You don't need to go back and start thinking about a machine learning at this moment. So there are something like ERP is a different part of this SDK. So ERP must be having an application. From that applications, you can always call that API based on that the ERP applications that you have developed in a particular language or particular. From ERP also, there may be a component that you can make a call the cognitive service any point in time. Yes, so it's asking that, so API is already trained. Yes, exactly, because then how am I supposed to get if it is not being trained to understand the metadata of a particular image? So how am I supposed to get the data then? So the API is already trained. It's fine. Okay, so there are a few questions which is not in that context, like how so I want to stick the question in the context of this, so what we are learning. So somebody asked about preparing an exam for an ML, so you can contact the respective. I think there are another series which is going on in the data series, the DP series. So of course you can ask questions from that context. But if you really need to know, then I'll be sharing my mail ID. So of course you can post me a mail, and probably I can provide you information on that context, the exam context. Oh, that is the last question that I'm going to answer now. So I'm going back to my presentation. All right, so somebody asked so we said, how do you ensure that the prediction that is being made by the cognitive service is correct? So this is something like in the world of cognitive service, in world of AI, everything is going by the percentage. The percentage in the sense like how closer, it is not 100% anytime. If you build your own model also, you won't be able to say that this is what the 100% is all about. The prediction is 100%. You can only anticipate by going by the numbers coming in context of how closer you are to that particular object you are about to identify by offering a percentage, by setting a number against that prediction. So you have to take a decisions from your applications from an outcome, what you're supposed to do, because the action is with you based on the outcome that has come from a cognitive service any given point in time. So that you have to take a call, that you have to go and understand or maybe make it available. So any given point in time. So this is something that you need to. So the we need to only go by the percentage, not by. The kind of guarantee that this would be something what has given by the cognitive service. There is no guarantee, but this is how the cognitive service world is running at this moment. What is being told, so you anticipate and you go and bank on those services, you go and bank on those outputs and take decisions. Okay, how can you do the All right, so that is something like, you know, if you're talking about hyperparameters, you know, in context of making it more, as I said, while you go and make a call to an APIs, the API will be coming with multiple parameters to modify your call, what exactly you are looking at. So as you go on, you can see the documentations, you are going to get all kind of informations to parameterize the call that you will be making rather than going with one parameters, the one informations that we are looking at any given. All right, so again, how it is different from the Google Cognitive Service. Yeah, as far as the concept of the cognitive service is universal, it is nothing to do with only Microsoft. So we go by the vendor. So we are not talking about that what we are doing in Microsoft platforms that Google cannot do. It is nothing like that. We are learning a technology which has come from a particular vendor. That's it. We are just exploring those services that has come. The same set of service may be coming from a Google. Same set of service may come out from an AWS. We never know. We need to explore. There may be a different session for that also. Google Cognitive Service. I think we do have the sessions in the subsequent one. But we are learning what Microsoft is offering at this moment. So as far as the technicality, as far as the, you know, kind of implementations, I don't see there is a difference because the kind of cognitive service they have, they're trying to deliver the same set of problem solutions, what Microsoft is trying to do. It is all about vendor to vendors. It's all about that you are building an ecosystem around the Microsoft technology. If you tomorrow, you have deployed so many applications on Microsoft Azure, of course, you are going to build solution around that services which is near to you from the same platform with the same subscriptions. You don't have to buy another subscription from a Google or you don't have to buy another subscription from somewhere else. So it's an integrated ecosystem that we are talking about. But you have always an option to go beyond Microsoft and talk about cognitive service whoever is offering at this moment. So nothing like that. So it's saying that these would be a never-ending conversation on these things. So who gives the better predictions in all about. So always remember that if you are not able to figure out the cognitive service output, what is being given, you can always go and do the customization. I keep telling that in the context of vision also, in the context of other cognitive service. So customization means, hope you understand that you keep coming back with the same questions. Okay. So hope you understand that, you know, the what I meant for a customization. Okay, so you always go and do the customizations any given point in time, because then you would be responsible to train on your own, and you would be responsible for, you know, making the entire predictions from your activity that you would be doing during the train, during the building of custom sort of the API that could be consumed from your application. So let me go back to, it's already done. So let me go back to my desktop now. So here is my Cosmos DB coming in. I can go to, you know, overview. So I can take an URL from here itself. So I go back to my app. So going with this endpoint, so exactly a different, only the name has come in there. Then I'll go with the key. This is my primary key. I copied this. I put it into the Cosmos DB endpoint key. And there would be a database under the Cosmos DB. If the database is not available, it will create the database. And inside the database of Cosmos DB, there would be a collections by the name called metadata, where analyzed data from the cognitive service would be stored permanently. Then somebody can pull in and somebody can always go and make a query what is being coming out. So coming back to the SDK, so now I have configured, because this is three things that I have configured from my application, .NET application. So what this application is going to do, this application is basically going to go and upload an image, analyze an image by calling. So here is something called processing library and the image storage library, as you can see. So if I go to the processing library, image processor, you know, so what SDK that I am using, you can see that Microsoft dot the project export or oxford.visions that you can see at this moment. So this is what the step wise. So if I made this code available to all of you, so you will get to know. But my point is that how you are getting integrated, how you are getting integrated with your applications with an SDK, that is something that we just need to see. So it means this SDK will enable a developer to write code in order to call your cognitive service. This is the point, or this is what we have been discussing so far. Hope you understand. So if you go back to your Node.js, or if you go back to your Java application, so it is all about an SDK that you have to bring back, and you have to start writing API code which is available in that particular SDK. So SDK meaning it's nothing but a DLL where you are going to find a type that you are going to use back on your application. So this particular piece of application will go and do the processing by calling a cognitive service. That cognitive service, the metadata, the configurations that we put into the settings, and you can see what we want. So you said, okay, I want the former need to be, the image need to be analyzed. So you're making a call to analyze the image that you are bypassing to the cognitive service. So this is what the integrations that we are talking about. And finally, you get a result, you get the captions and the tags and what you have come out, and probably you are going to go and print that this tag, or as a result, somebody is going to call that image processor and get it inside. So what are the things that we are going to go and capture from an underlying image and so on and so forth? Service helper, how the service is going to go and call. At the same time, how you are going to go and store data into the storage. Data means in our case would be an image, DB service. Again, you will be going and working with some kind of, you know, talking to the Cosmos DB with the Cosmos DB SDK. But here we are not looking at the Cosmos DB, but here we are looking at more on the integrations of your cognitive API with your underlying applications in order to process the images based on what you want. So we'll not hang on a more time on that, because this is what to give you, you know, that the fair idea that, you know, you should not be kind of come to a conclusion that we should be always go and, you know, sort of all this EPF from the canvas that is coming from the Microsoft. You can, because we have been talking about building AI applications. So hypothetically, this could be an AI application who can analyze an image, right? So who can do many things in context of what is being offered by the API at this moment. All right, so let's go back to, yeah, so we are done with this. We can build this application. All this, the three combined stuff is being run successfully. And then I can go back to my application folder. Here we are. So I go back. The command that is there inside this folder. So what I have my image folder, just give me a minute. So I do have my image folder also there. This is the image folder. So I'm going to go and I run this one from .NET run. So let us see how it's get the pull in the image from the physical folder, unlike that we store that image inside the storage account inside a container, and we have made this container public and we use this. All right. All right, so I got it because I just need to update my connection string for the storage. So let me go to my storage account. Give me a time. So go to my dashboard, bring my storage account key. Go to my, because it's trying to connect the storage account. So I need to give my connection string of the storage account. So let me go back to my configurations out here. It was not the storage account key that I'm using so far. So let me save it again. So this is the storage account name that we can see. I have given like, so I think the name is something I know that I have given. Okay, some typing mistake out there, so that's fine. So I'll go back and rerun my command. Essentially what we are trying to give this command saying that, okay, let's go and figure out those images from a particular physical folder, upload to the storage, and then you start processing that images. So who will process this image? The processing is done by the cognitive service, that is your computer vision. So you can see that every image is getting uploaded to the Microsoft Azure storage account, is being pulled by a cognitive service and send the result back to my client application. So since we can make this client application really robust, like, you know, I can make it something like, you know, desktop applications or a web application, it doesn't, you know, make any differences as long as we need to understand that concept. So every image going into the cognitive service is quickly giving me the detail of that image. I can pick up one of them. I can start looking at what has come out of this cognitive service or so far at this moment. So this is kind of, so you are integrating, you are building an applications, you know, where you are analyzing your images and you're storing the metadata in a form of JSON document that you can pull in from the multiple, applications to, you know, to kind of create a meaningful, or maybe to take a meaningful decisions on those data. So you can always go and do that. So here we are. So keep going on that. So in the meantime, it will take, because it's a couple of 10 or 11 images once this is done. So I'll go back and walk you through what is being done under my subscriptions through this application. So first, let me go to my storage account. So inside the container, so I get my image folder. Previously, it was empty. Now I can see all the images is being pumped into the cloud, you know, for future reference for my application. That is number one. Number two, I will go to the Cosmos DB, and then I'll go to the Data Explorer. So I'll try and connect to my Data Explorer under my database, under my collection. You will see the items. So inside the items, you can pull one item which is being fed in. So you can say, okay, a man swimming in the pool. So let me just read it that you can see in detail like this. So here it is, a man swimming in the pool of water. This is being analyzed. And you pick up the image from the blob URI and the name of the image and other metadata which is going to tag under this. So these are the tags getting in. So my application can pull this information from this, and probably you can take a decision based on that. That is something what we have been doing. So collectively using an SDK, how we integrate the cognitive service and with the other service to give a solutions to the end user or end customer. And this is what we are discussing so far. All right. So you use the three things together. You use your Cosmos DB, you use the storage, and you use the cognitive service. And this all is being configured under this configuration settings that you see. So respective API or respective, you know, the SDK to deal with the respective API is being programmed under these applications and made it happen. Right. So this is how we can build an intelligence application that we are talking about, because we have been discussing how we're supposed to build an AI applications where we can incorporate the cognitive service. So it is not only a one cognitive service, there are multiple cognitive service that we are going to discuss. So at this moment, I'll take a 10 minutes break because this session will go another half an hour, as I can see. So I'll just take a 5 minutes break, not a 10 minutes break. So I'll take a 5 minutes break, the bio break. So in 5 minutes, we'll come back and I will walk you through a couple of more the services under the cognitive service banner from Microsoft Azure. So let's take a break of 5 minutes and we'll come back and start with the rest of the presentations that I need to walk you through.
Hello everyone, this is Priyanka again. I hope you all can hear me. So while Navjyoti sir has given the break, I would like to tell you something interesting.
Yeah, Priyanka, go ahead.
Yes, sir. I hope you all can see my screen.
Yep.
So today is the second webinar from the live AI on Azure meetup series. So there are two more virtual meetups, which is on 4th June and 18th June. So if you want to register, you can visit our social media or visit our company's website to attend this upcoming virtual meetup. One more thing, we are coming with this Azure Python workshop. There are two whole day workshop training and two webinars in this Azure Python series, workshop series. So while if you want to register, we are always welcome. We are taking as many as entries. But while coming to the workshop, this is a training for a whole month. There are two is on 6th June and second one is on 28th June. So we are taking limited entries from each company. So if maybe you are having, there are 10 members from one company, then we are going to take only 5 from each company. So if possible, try to register as soon as possible. So there.
So where I can register?
You can just mail me your details. I will also share this workshop details with you with the registration link. Also, you can visit our social media. So from there, also you can get the direct link for the registration. So there is one more thing. There are digital swag. So while you have registered with us for the webinars or workshops or for meetups, we will mail you the attendee link, or maybe we will send the mail of invitations, then thank you mail, miss you mail. So in the end of the mail, there is a content which is shared directly by the mic. That are the digital swags, and also with that digital swags, we have also give you the links of our upcoming meetups and webinars. So there is one more webinar. We have already done two webinars. One is on DP200 and DP201, and the next webinar on DP100, which is on 19 June 2020. So if you have already attended a previous webinar, you can also register for this webinar. Or if you haven't attended previous webinar, just visit our YouTube channel for the recording. So from there, you can get the recordings of previous webinars or virtual meetups. And now you can register for this one. So here is one interesting thing. Learn, certify, upgrade, and get a chance to win Surface Go. So Microsoft and Synergetics are coming with this interesting campaign, which is a data and AI certification campaign. So this campaign is started from 19th May. It has been already started, and the end date of the campaign is 19th June. So you just need to complete your data or AI certification. So after this 1 month duration, they will get a chance to win a Surface Go. So what are the steps to follow to complete this certifications and to get eligible to win this Surface Go? So you need to register and accept the campaign terms and conditions. Then you need to complete your certification in between 19 May to 19 June then you need to post your certification badge on your LinkedIn, and after that you will get eligible for to get a Surface Go, and it will be a lucky draw. So if you need more information about this certification and campaign, and you are really interested in winning a Surface Go, you just need email me your details. So we will give you an the more information and each and every detail of this campaign. So this is a win-win situation for you guys. If you complete your certification, you will complete your certification as well as you will get a chance to win this Surface Go. So while we are sitting in at our homes, we can just complete our certification. It is a chance for ourselves to upgrade ourselves with MS Azure certification. So these are the four main reasons why you want to complete your certification. So I have you all can have some of these reasons, you can read that. But also we had already done how to take online certification, or how to complete your certification, or you can give your exam just by sitting home. We have done a webinar on this. If you want the recording or recordings for this webinar, you just need to visit our YouTube channel. If you didn't see a recording at there, just text me, because we have put that recording as a private. So we are not going to give everyone this recording. Because there is a private content which we have showed in that webinar. So if you want the recordings of this webinars, you need to follow some process. So in this COVID situation, as you all are attending these meetups and webinars, you already know Synergetics initiative that we are coming with a webinar series, meetup series, and now we are coming with a Python whole day training workshop and two webinars. And also now we are launching this AI and data campaign, certification campaign. So this is a virtual training calendar for May and for the month of June. So here you can see our calendar for the certifications. And there is one more thing. While you are this certification or training, the cost of certifications training and the exam is very extremely high. But if you come to us and if you want to complete your certification, you will get the live training as well as MOC and exam voucher in just 17,500. And one more thing I would like to tell you, that we have launched this data and AI campaign. So if you come during us for this training and certification in between 19th May to 19th June, we will give you this trainings plus exam voucher plus MOC in just rupees 15,000. But first you need to enroll with us with all the with the whole amount, which is 17,500. Once you complete your certification and you add your badge on your LinkedIn, after that we will give you 2,500 rupees back. So you will complete your certification in just rupees 15,000. So this is a special discount offer. I haven't changed the date. 15th May, we have just decided that we are going to extend this date only for you guys. So you will get a special 10% discount in purchase of our certification. So this offer will valid till 25th of May. So if you want to register for a data and AI campaign, or you want to complete your certification, you can directly contact our concerned person, which is Shilpa Award. We have shown her mobile number and email ID on the screen. Also, you can just mail me your details and which certification you are looking for. Also you can send me your details. I will just forward it to the concerned person. So thank you. And one last announcement is about if you want a participation certificate for today's webinar, today's virtual meetup, and you haven't registered with us, you need to send me your details on my mail ID. After that, you will get the certificate for today's. After that, you will get a survey form. Once you fill that survey form, you will get the participation certificate. So once again, thank you. And now we can continue with our today's session.
Yeah, thank you, Priyanka. So before I stepped into my presentations, let me answer the last question. I think only that question is not answered. Somebody asked, Basudeva has asked, why not .NET Python received a session from the SDK and Perse? This is already done. Hope you have seen the demo. So hope probably you could anticipate, because this was the JSON data that we get back. If you go back, these are the JSON. So it's already done. So your question, I did not understand. But anyway, so the using of Cosmos DB here is for keeping the data for the future use. You are getting data online, converting into the JSON back on the system. This is already done, what your question is asked. But let me bring the context why the Cosmos DB, because the Cosmos DB would be used to store that metadata for future reuse. You never know what kind of service is going to go and pull those data and make those data meaningful to their respective context or use cases. Okay, hope I, so you got that particular ask. All right. So
to interrupt you.
Yeah.
Actually, the same cognitive service we have used in our HP account, and you are right. Actually, for identify that whether our HP provide the multiple services like laptop or desktop, or like printer or Xerox. So using the cognitive service, we had achieved that which things it is. It is desktop, it is laptop or what. So by doing that, we implemented these things and stored in the Cosmos DB for further use in the application.
Right. Yeah, because the only one thing that you need to understand, why do you select the Cosmos DB? So I just give a brief about the Cosmos DB. Then we have to sit back and start talking about Cosmos DB. So this is not the session, but I said that, yes, data is being stored in a form of JSON. And while the data is being stored in form of JSON, so it become easy for the underlying application to pull those data without doing a lot of serialization. So because it's a plain, simple text. And it will enhance the performance in terms of operating those data to take a decision. There are many things, but at this moment in the brief that we would be using those metadata for future use, that's why we are keeping in a very most used service from a Microsoft Azure, that is Cosmos DB. And you go back and figure out what Cosmos DB is all about and why the Cosmos DB is so important in the ecosystem of AI or IoT, or maybe data science. You will get to know that. But anyway, so coming back to my presentation, I have got 20 minutes or maybe 15 minutes more to go, and I will just run you through with my PPT the other services under the cognitive service. So, but before I go there, I just want to just set the context once again, what we have done so far. The first thing we talk about, what is cognitive service? What cognitive service can deliver? That's number one. Now we have identified the list of cognitive service from Microsoft Azure Cloud Platform. And then the same context we talked about how and why Microsoft cognitive service is so important. We talk about flexibility, we talk about easy to use, and we talk about the endorsement, the testing and the project and so on and so forth. And then we start really gone and implement and see. One, I have given a demo to make a direct call to the cognitive service from the canvas that is coming out of the API. The other, how the developer will go and integrate the cognitive service by using the respective SDK. People, a lot of people ask me about what about Python, what about Node.js, and what, as I say, so you go and find the SDK that you can use with the respective language and keep calling those cognitive service. Because we just need to get a fair idea how cognitive service can be integrated in the underlying application using respective SDK that has come from the Microsoft Azure. That is also done. But at the same time, I have gone and talked about a kind of simple ecosystem, how the cognitive service is going to use some important services from the Microsoft Azure, because the cognitive also coming from an Azure, you know, but how the few services would be relevant to the cognitive service, like Stories or Cosmos DB and so on and so forth. So later on, you can keep building your own ecosystem, keep building your own relevant services, you know, whichever way you would like to give a solutions based on the particular workload. And so that is up to, but we got a fair idea how it can be integrated, how it can be put together to build a kind of solution. So what I have discussed through my application. All right, so going forward in the OCR, I talked about that if I want to read some kind of text. From your image through the cognitive service. This is how you can go and read it. Coming out of this, where it is like, you know, you can see all those texts that is being returned as a JSON content. What is being read through this image, the OCR also. Scan document photos with the text and find gain location informations and so on and so forth. So I talked about the cropping off and the creating thumbnail of an existing image without losing the content. That is also possible through the computer vision's API that we have been discussing so far. You can see that, how this is being done. So there are a lot of case studies around the computer vision. So I don't want to get into the case studies at this moment, but yes. So you can always look up to the case studies, how cognitive service, especially the vision API that we have been talking about, is being used around the different problem statement to get the solutions or bring the productivity within an organization and reduce the cost, what they incurred by implementing the traditional solution. So you can always go and kind of refer to a multiple use cases or multiple case studies from the Microsoft, the official documentation site. Right, so these are a few things that I will, as I said before, also I'll walk you through quickly, the rest of the cognitive service. We talk about most of them, we discuss just to step by step, one by one, that we are talking about emotion API, you know, understand the content within an image. So you can see how the emotion is being identified, anger or contempt or disgust or fear, happiness, neutral, sadness and surprise, like, you know, so that is something that you see all the data coming in a form of JSON again. So it's a consistent model. It is not going to see a different model. It's all about the behavior. So behavior will change, the data will change. Right, so face ID, face detection. So you can identify the similar face, the face verifications, face grouping, to organize the many faces into a one group based on some kind of parameters, and face identifications, like, you know, belongs to a particular face. So this is how the face API is going to work. So you can see that it's a rectangular box where the face is being accommodated, and start reading the data, start reading the object by cognitive service from that underlying image and come up with some kind of meaningful data that could be used by your application. So content moderator also as a kind of machine assistant moderations for the text and the image, augmented with the human review tools, all these things, you know, you need to moderate the content. So if the content's coming into you, so cognitive service is going to help you to moderate. So they will highlight the objection or maybe the unwanted the content or unwanted word or a sentence from the text that you have written, including the videos. So it is all about how you're supposed to moderate using a cognitive service. And you know by what the moderator or what the moderations that we are talking about. So it's you are going to get an so it's all about getting an assistant from the machines. Rather you use a human, unlike the traditional application. So AI application can perform the human a task, a human job. So I told you before also like customizations, you know, so customization is something that you can always do that. So if you're not sure about, you know, what will be the outcome of the ready-made API, so you can always go and train your own image. So you can publish that particular model as a service, and you can always consume from your application. So that is always there with the steps like upload image, train and evaluate, and active learning. So start machine learning, will learn those images, create a model out of those learning, and then keep using. And based on that learning, so probably the service that you have created should be able to predict the incoming images if you want to evaluate subsequently. So video indexer also we talked about, you know, so what it does. So yes, I mean like upload your videos and go and start tuning your video into Insight. Basically, just to brief one thing before you you can read the slide, I don't want to read that. But knowing an insight of a video is extremely important today. If somebody is speaking in a forum, so with the live videos, so I should be able to go and capture the metadata, you know, so that is something possibly we can go and do that. It's saying that what is, as I said, what would be the intent of the speaker on what topic or what content or what context the speaker is speaking. So getting insight to the videos. So you can engage with the videos, you know, with the metadata that is going to be available for you using cognitive service. So this is also kind of the speech API that we see talk about voice recognition. So you can recognize a voice. Again, synthesize the audios from the text. So you write a text, it will be converted into an audio at real time. So you can use in different contexts the speech intent recognitions, like, you know, so what kind of intent of that particular conversations that is happening. And this, if somebody is speaking, so you can anticipate what is the intent of the a speaker through their words they're using throughout the conversation. So there are a few case study around those cognitive service. So it is not like only one thing that we see, multiple going forward. And of course you can, as I said, the customization also is possible. So you can tailor the speech recognitions to your app and environment. So how the customs piece is being developed, you know, you record, you transcript the recording, and you adapt with some kind of requirement by creating a model to better match with the expected environment of the application's user. And finally deploy to a custom endpoints, and finally access from any device who's supposed to record the audios or maybe kind of speech. So there are also kind of the case study around those, as I said, like before also, it is all about finding those case studies, understanding how the company's organizations is being benefited using all kind of cognitive service going forward. Speaker recognitions also. The same, the speaker identification, identify who is speaking and so on and so forth. So there would be an API, create a unique voice print for a particular profile, recognitions and verifications, confirm if the voice belongs to that previously enrolled profiles and so on and so forth. So these are inner working. So I don't want to get into a detail. So once you get into a detailed session, because this cognitive service, typically we can deliver in, you know, 3 to 5 days of training to complete all the services with the real life example and so on and so forth. And that thing should be really, really robust. Here it is only just to get you aligned with what is happening in this world. So this is like spill, something to do with the spill checking that typically you introduce in your AI application. So wide variety of spelling errors and recognize today you can see that, you know, suppose if you're writing an essay or if you're writing a SOP for getting into an university, so you can buy a lot of AI based application. So in fact, I do have one application, so where I can go and write an essay or maybe some kind of business letter, so that application itself is going to give me a not only correct the spelling that I'm writing, or it will go and give me the suggestions to better frame the sentences, and that it would be more communicative. It become more communicative to the rest of the world, kind of thing. So, you know, so you get a lot of applications based on the AI today and working with this front, you know, so that is, and it is not only one thing. It is not like a dictionary who will simply go and check the spelling. So beyond that also, it gives you the suggestions and other stuff. Making sentence, you know, relevant sentence in a particular domain and so on and so forth. The things are becoming really robust going forward. We said to get the suggestion, something like that. Yeah, so that is your trying to understand what user is talking about, what user is speaking through a different applications. Maybe the bot is one of them. As I said before also, I have explained the role of bot along with the cognitive service. So that is the language understanding intelligent services, like in many cases, when you interact with a smart application, so like bot, so we go and keep asking multiple questions, or maybe we keep communicating with your own language. The biggest questions at this point in time, whether the other party who's supposed to interpret what you are speaking is the gone through or not, because until that particular applications or that particular bot cannot interpret what you're talking about, then that bot or that application won't be able to respond to you what you're supposed to get as a next response. So it is really, really important of language understanding by the AI applications in order to make your communications poor and more meaningful to the point answer, to get the to the point answer is being asked by a customer or an end user any given point in time. Right, so that is something like news about the flight delays. So that is something that you get intent that you figure out. So your language understanding model is basically go and picks up the intent, what people are. So it says the fine news would be a 99% closer intent to the talk that you are doing, the news about the flight delays. So something like that, you can see the figure out. So non-intent is 07, okay, the read news is 01, and the share news is 09, but here you say 99% of getting closer to that intent. What is your intent? What is being asked by this user? So on and so forth. Right, so the linguistic analysis is also the tool that it is basically a necessary language processing because, when you talk or when you communicate with an application, it is really important for analyzing, identifying the concept behind what you are talking about or maybe what you are trying to communicate. This is going again, for example, I have written a comment. Okay, maybe I said, okay, whether this comment is some kind of very rude comment or maybe a kind of neutral comment or maybe a very kind of, good comments or something like that. This is going under the analysis. So you can analyze whatever you have written through a particular language going forward. So you will go and get a lot of things under that. You will be talking about sentiment and all these things. So what is the sentiment of the user when somebody is going through an analysis of your text that you have written, the language that you use, and so all these things under the text analytics that you are going to go and see that. Sentiment, key phrase, extractions and language detections and so on and so forth will come under this. So these are important thing aspect because the people using in different use cases. Web language model also, I don't want to hold you back in there. Preparing and predicting following word in a sequence and so on and so forth. So translator, the text API we talked about already, so I don't even want to go and reiterate, but it's like a flow one after another and then getting into a kind of knowledge, evaluate the query expressions and return the academic knowledge entity result. You can see entity linking also another process, name entity recognitions, and because entity is another concept which is broad level, we need to understand entity can be replaced by anything, so entity can be a kind of the name of a dog or a name of a cat, so that could be is going to hold the values in the cognitive service. So this is what we have already talked about, so working with query auto completions and use and all this thing, attribute histogram. So these are a bit of advanced implementations going with the knowledge based stuffs. Recommendations also the one thing, increase that catalog discovery, personalize your experience. So you logged into a particular e-commerce site, so you get your recommendations right there. You personalize every time you go inside that e-commerce site to buy something. You see all these things, you know. So that is with the help of analytics and a cognitive service that you get to see all those implementation around you. So there are again the case studies that you can see around all these things that I'm talking about in more in detail. Right, so finally the Q&A maker, I have already explained about the Q&A maker. So it is basically nothing but if we really want to interact with an intelligent applications, you may have a lot of FAQ. So those FAQ would be a train. So in order to respond, in order to answer you any given point in time, but you upload the Q&A, you train it and you ask, keep asking questions. That is also going into a custom decision service, cloud-based contextual decisions making API that sharpen with an experience at like, you know, what context that you are, your informations to be provided and so on and so forth. All right, so these are basically coming into kind of, end of this presentation with the walkthrough with the different the cognitive service and their categories and the implementation around the world by multiple customers and their story that is being told through those case studies. All right, so you can always find the developer resources like the pricing about the cognitive service, documentations on that, SDKs, an example code in GitHub and so on and so forth. All right, so I just want to thank you all of you because we are already 1:12 at this moment and hope the participations of this particular training they gave you the information about the cognitive service from the Microsoft Azure, and probably you can go back and start analyzing those services and start creating context in order to use them in the respective workload that you are working today or you are about to work in the near future. So I would like to thank from my desk to all of you and hope to see you in the near future with the sequence of the webinar that we are going to have under that particular themes. So in case you have any queries or any kind of you can see my mail ID right in front, you can always mail me on that mail ID. So once again, thank you all for attending this webinar on building AI solutions with a cognitive service.
Thank you. It's really amazing session. We have learned
thank you
a lot.
Yeah.
So could you do another favor for us? Could you just provide the URL to download the sample application which you have just shown in that session?
Yeah, sure. So I'll give you that sample, that the sample application that I am using, you are asking that?
Yeah, which you have just provided, I mean, which you have just.
So do a mail me that, you know, so I will respond on the mail. So hope you have my mail ID.
Yeah.
This is Priyanka again, and thank you so much, Navjyoti sir, for such a wonderful session, and thank you everyone for joining us. And I have also shared my mail ID in the message box. So if you have any query regarding anything, certification, upcoming webinar, just email me and I will just give it back to you. So thank you once again. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Priyanka, for coordinating the session. And that's it from my end. So I'll be signing off from my session now. So still, if you have any question.
We have one question. I mean, regarding there are many Microsoft have provided API. So we don't know what suppose that we have a sample of face detection, so multiple algorithm is provided by Microsoft. So we don't know that time which algorithm is used. Sometimes they have in sample, they use like decision fast tree or fast binary tree or decision tree. So we get confused. So what is the best way to overcome on this?
Okay, so you are saying that, see, as we say, this cognitive service, if you go by the cognitive service until you go and create your own model by using your respective algorithm that you are talking about. So as long as you go with the ready-made services, the cognitive service, you only can call those API. You won't be able to modify. You won't be able to go and see the underlying, the models or underlying algorithms they are using. So, but yes, you will get a fair idea by going into a documentation how those cognitive services are being developed. But the metadata of the cognitive service is not publicly available. So I would definitely go and tell you that if you have some kind of confusion, or maybe you do not know what kind of algorithm, or you are going with, you want to use a particular algorithm, I will definitely go and say in context of custom, in context of a vision API also, you can go and work with the custom vision API. You can always do that. So my suggestion would be going with always custom vision APIs. So where you can customize with your own API. Right then, so I will be signing off.
Thank you.